So thank you everyone for coming. Thanks for spoiling your lunch hour. I'm Mark Simon. I'm going to present a little bit of what I call WYSIWYG. What you build is what you get. As e-learning designers, hopefully you've been down this road before, and maybe you're here because you know you've experienced this same sort of thing. I'm going to try to offer you a couple of different tips. I'm going to do some demonstrations. I have an iPad. I have a phone. I'm probably going to try to demo on each one of these. To what extent the success will be, you never know. But okay, let's go in and take a look through what this is. So first of all, everybody knows, sorry, you guys are all so young. Nobody here probably knows what WYSIWYG was. Anybody here know what WYSIWYG is? Yes? What was it? That's right, what you see is what you get. And so it was done back in the 1980s when there were word processors that didn't show exactly what was going to be printed. You took a guess and you said print, and you never knew what would happen, right? Okay, well here's our dilemma now, or our new world for e-learning. If you spend some time building something and you get everything aligned just right, and you click on the print button, or the publish button in this case, and what you build is what you get, is the new phrase, so WYSIWYG. Yeah. Okay, so what's WYSIWYG? I just defined it. Okay, so here on the left is what I just built, right? Whether I'm using a PowerPoint tool or whatever freeform tool that you have, that's what I built. And then I clicked on the publish button, and not quite. Okay, it does happen, and it happens sometimes, and then how do we fix it? Okay, so one of the common ways that this happens, okay, and that we're finding a lot, is that when we go mobile especially, okay, does it play exactly the same on the iPad? It's one thing that it doesn't work on the workstation. As an author, you can test on the workstation, right? Okay, you know what, it works on my workstation. I authored on the workstation, it works on the workstation, but here's the dilemma. You basically have somebody that says, oh, my e-learning tool now does mobile, right? And this is great. And then how can you tell it does great mobile? Well, it's got a checkbox, right? There for HTML5. And honestly, this is, again, another one of our hurdles to overcome. As instructional designers, you know, we're full of hurdles, and so we have to try to figure this out. Okay, let's talk about some steps that you can take to prevent. And then I want to show you some examples of how this may not work for you, and we'll demo on iPad, etc. Okay, number one, make sure you test the finish line and not the starting line. All right, too many times you take a look at the tool. Oh boy, it's got this feature, it's got that feature. It looks great, and it's got a publish button. You know, it must be fine. The finish line in this case is not just okay. Your workstation, it doesn't work on your workstation. You know, if you're publishing for tablets, and I'm going to show you a little graphic on how tablets have exploded in the workplace, test on the tablet, okay? So test the finish line, not the starting line. What's the science guy doing up here, right? I don't know how he's up there. Oh, yeah, that's right. Sorry, he's supposed to be there. So here's what I do when I do my testing, and I test a lot of different tools. I use a controlled document. Okay, whether it's a storyboard or whether it's an actual document, if you're using a PowerPoint-based tool like iSpring, which is, by the way, our sponsor here, I'm happy to have some of the iSpring folks here, get a controlled document together. You're trying to assess how does this work in my tool, but then you're trying to evaluate another tool. Use the same 10 slides, 10 things, test out the quiz tool, test out all the elements if you can. But basically try to come up with one control document to use. The third tip would be test it on your learner's platform. Meaning if this thing is running on a different device, and even more than that, if it's running on a learning management system, make sure it runs on the learning management system. You know, a lot of people don't talk about that when it comes to mobile, because you assume, oh, you know what, I published it and now I can see it on my iPad, all right? But they don't talk about, okay, the LMS itself has to have mobile capability also. I just went through an evaluation period for one of my clients. They're a global pharmaceutical company in the Boston area. And basically, nobody was testing mobile. on the LMS, and there was a vast difference between Cornerstone and SuccessFactors and Saba and the tools that they were evaluating on the learning management system. And you know, you really have to evaluate how is this tool going to look once the users start using it or the learners start using it on their platform. Okay, here's a novel step to take. I think we probably all do this to a certain extent, but Google, okay? So for all these tools that are out there, I know that some tool vendors like to hide, you know, maybe some of the things they do, but a lot of the tools vendors do not. Okay, Articulate's a great example of a vendor that's very transparent. Their community out there, you can Google anything. Tell me, you know, Articulate storyline issues importing PowerPoint. Okay, they have pages out there. How many of my animations from PowerPoint are going to be converted over with Articulate Presenter? Try to do the Google, okay, before you try to evaluate any issues. Sometimes I'll take a tool and I'll just type in tool name, fill in the blank, issues or problems, okay? And then of course Google completes that phrase, you know, and while you're evaluating these tools, you know, you should have an awareness of, okay, what really works and what doesn't work. Good, bad, or indifferent. Okay, here's another thing that happens fairly often, and you have to be really aware of this. You convert from your storyboard PowerPoint over to e-learning, and not everything completely works. Okay, this is something to just be wary of, no matter what the tool is. Okay, yes, again, it's like that checkbox thing. Yeah, we'll convert over your PowerPoint. Just author in PowerPoint. I work for a company that's actually very famous. They're an IT research company in the Boston area. I'm not allowed to even say what name it is. But just the smartest people I've ever worked with in my life. These guys were brilliant. They write all kinds of white papers. They were going PowerPoint to storyline. You know, that was their model. And if you look it up, you know, just again, it's one thing you can do with a Google. You find out the limitations of going from PowerPoint over to storyline. You know, every tool has little limitations, and I won't go into the details of the limitations with storyline specifically. But you know, again, you should have an awareness that that routine there is not a guarantee that what you see and what you build, rather, is what you're going to get. Right? Now, just a couple more slides. I kind of referred to this before with the LMS. But make sure that you you also test on the user's devices, okay? Don't forget about browsers, okay? You know, when it comes to the tools, you know, it runs just great under Chrome. But, you know, if your user base has IE, you know, you have to test it on IE, you know? And maybe just a quick smoke test on Firefox would be a bad idea, not to mention the Mac browsers like Safari. Right? You want to limit the amount of testing that you do. I mean, there's a whole other world there about, okay, how can I test effectively? There's so many devices, there's so many browsers, what about this version of this browser, and so on and so forth. But again, you know, try to identify your user base first and test it on as many devices as you know your users will be using. So this slide, I just read this in the Wall Street Journal this week, okay? So basically, what you've got, I hear a lot of people say, well, we're not going mobile. We're not going mobile. I have another client or whatever that kept on telling me, don't worry about mobile. We're not there yet. And they aren't. But this is where the world is going in terms of mobile. So notice the PCs in the workplace. So this is Fortune 500 companies, right? And it just came out from IDC. It's increased about 15%, okay, over the last 5 years. The Mac has increased 133%, so it's becoming a little bit more common to see Macs in the workplace. But the big wow is down there on the tablet level, all right? People are embracing tablets. Look at the 6 million quantity for tablets, okay? That means for every one MacBook or Mac Air or whatever you've got inside the workplace, there's six different tablets, okay? Some departments, obviously sales has tablets, but there's a lot more that are adopting the tablet idea as one of those devices that they want. And if they access your app on a tablet, you know, you could be in some trouble. Okay, Yeah. Questions, thoughts, comments as I juggle my adapters and keep my fingers crossed that this is actually going to work? How many people here have actually experienced some Wibby Wig? Anybody? Okay. So, you know, it seems to be becoming more and more common. So let me get this plugged in to start. Hey, look at that. Better than my laptop. Okay. I'm going to go back over to my inbox. All right. So here's what I did. Over the last 5 or 6 weeks, I started basically taking that control document. I have a PowerPoint slide deck with 10 slides in it. And I basically went through, I'm a consultant, so I use all these different tools depending on who my client is and so on and so forth. And I started going through the different tools with the same one. And I would just click on publish. Okay, and so what I did then was I copied them out to Dropbox. Okay, not the ideal, right? Because Dropbox is just, you know, one, it's a platform that probably people won't use, but it's the closest thing I could get to a shared area with has that kind of LMS element to it. So all of these links here are to a Dropbox account. So if I go into iSpring as an example, and I usually use iSpring because honestly, I find that usually there's not a flaw, and I'm biased. You know, I'm working with the iSpring folks. If you haven't had a chance to go over and see the iSpring booth, please do. But this is the way it is supposed to work, and this is on an iPad. So for those of you that don't know iSpring very well, iSpring basically will read the pixel density of the learner, and then basically show you and display for you this in different modes. So what it does is it's scrunched up the contents bar on the right-hand side, and it's reduced down the size of the navigation bar on the bottom, so you get a little bit more real estate to look at while you're on a smaller device, all right? And then as you go from one thing to another, you notice the transition or whatever slide, and do that little spin thing. You know, if you like transitions, iSpring does all transition. iSpring also does all animations, so that both what you see is what you get, you know, tends to turn out to be something that's more like what you want. So now I've got this thing set up with a couple of PowerPoint triggers. How many people here knew that PowerPoint did triggers, does triggers? Okay. Anybody here use PowerPoint and triggers? Just out of curiosity. Okay, great. Got a few. Again, I use this one with some triggers. I know that some tools do it and some tools do not. Believe it or not, that pop, it had a little pop sound to it. You can put in sounds and so on and so forth. For those folks that have seen this before, I tried to do a couple of like little things with timing animations and try to make this a little bit challenging, okay? That's another element you'll have to decide for yourself. If you're showing your boss why you bought this tool and you know it doesn't work so well, keep the PowerPoint simple, right? But if you're trying to test it for yourself, you know, don't just have five slides that are all bullets, right? And, you know, try to put in some things that you think, okay, I hope that all these tools will work. So I think everybody here has probably seen, I'll go to just one more slide. This is a timeline interaction. You know, most of the PowerPoint tools have these interactions, and this is just again, testing out the behavior and the capabilities within this area. This one tests out, you know, just the timeline of the Red Sox, which I know everyone's probably interested to see what, you know, the major milestones are for the Boston Red Sox over the past several years. So I'll leave it at Manny comes to Boston. It was certainly a historic moment. It kind of brings a tear to my eye, and many people, of course, are Red Sox fans. Sorry, it's very controversial, of course. Okay, so you get the idea, right? All right. So let's go back and let's just take a look. Which one do you want next? We'll try the Articulate Suite, maybe the Adobe Suite. Okay. And then I can show you also storyline. You know, I honestly, when I do these things, I don't know exactly what to expect. And I found that storyline was actually very well behaved. I had, honestly, like one small glitch of something that didn't quite work the way that I was hoping it would work. Nice default feature, by the way, for Adobe Presenter. Articulate Presenter. I just discovered the other day that iSpring doesn't do this by default. It's got a checkbox or whatever. But Articulate has done this by default. And again, these are little things that you may notice as you go through your testing. You notice the little animation with the popping of bubble? Perfect. Look great. I use default settings. I don't mess around a lot with anything else. So let's go into what is a trigger. Now, there's two things that happened a little weird in this case. All right, anybody want to see the first weird thing? The one with the bubble. And for the extra points, anybody notice anything else that wasn't there? Yeah, the text on the top of the bubble. Right, is wrong. But there was one other thing, and it was subtle. The slide transition, going from the first slide to the second slide, again, it's something that doesn't happen, okay? Now, in my PowerPoint, I wanted that to happen, or maybe I didn't care about it happening, but again, you should notice that as being a difference, okay? And then as you go through this again, let's see, I'll go into my little pop quiz. So I've got a little pop quiz here. We know that Articulate does not do triggers, but you'll notice even with the animation there, the you win, you lose sort of thing was actually hidden. It's supposed to be hidden behind the balloon, and it shows up right away. So again, a little bit of a difference. And then you go into my favorite thing, and I'll go into, again, the history of the Boston Red Sox, basically about the same. All right, you got a storyline down here. Now, the one thing that I didn't like, you notice those buttons on the bottom for the events? Okay, they're all squeezed in. And I don't know, many of you might have the dexterity and the capability to click with precision, but it is more difficult, right? And so, testing out the actual interaction, you know, okay, not just, oh, this is easy to use, because it really is. You know, if you haven't had the pleasure of using Engage, Engage comes with like 20 different interactions, and really it's great to have those as an option. But you know, you really have to, again, compare apples to apples if you can. That's my lunchtime joke, I guess. No, I was just putting that one out there. So, and you can go through here just to, again, test out the results and how did this work. I took it also to a level where I put in a quiz. Okay. And, you know, one thing, if you haven't discovered the slide view inside of Articulate Quizmaker, it's now a really nice thing. It allows you to put a little background. It looks a lot better, by the way, on my screen than it does right here, probably because of lighting. But this is nice to be able to put in an image and then some background color and things like that. And I can go ahead and select this, click on Submit. You know, it behaves very well. I thought it was appropriate to have little tulips here because it's springtime, right? So we got a tulip question and so on and so forth. And then the final thing I did as a challenge was to put in the weather report, okay? And the weather report, almost all the tools have the ability to put in a live weather report here. And you can see it worked just fine. So this is kind of a cool thing. If you haven't done this within your lessons, if you have a website, you can actually make the website show up here. You can have your user actually click around live on a slide, you know, just by basically putting in that little link to your website. So far, so good. So let me go back over now. Back to my mail. Here. Adobe Presenter. Anybody using Adobe Presenter? Just out of curiosity. Okay, Gene? Nice. So Adobe Presenter, I published by to web and to LMS to see the difference. And I just realized I clicked on the web link, and I think this is, there's at least one thing that won't work, and that's the quiz, because I believe to have the quiz display in Adobe Presenter, you have to have it published in LMS. So this may be a little bit of an unfair task, but let's just see how Adobe Presenter does. So again, it's basically the same idea. I got the same 10 slides or 15 slides that I'm putting together, and just have I go through the test. What's wrong with this picture? Bubbles didn't pop. And honestly, I don't know. This has been repeated behavior. I don't know why. You know, and I should probably stop by the Adobe booth to figure out whether there's something weird that happened. But again, I use the same PowerPoint, so you would assume that it might work. The other thing that's a little peculiar here, what's missing from this picture? There's something not there that was there for both of the other ones. What? Yeah, well, this slide doesn't have triggers yet. How about a navigation bar? Right? So there's no navigation bar. I didn't publish it to tell it not to give me a navigation bar. But it was smart enough to say, okay, I'm displaying this. If I display this on my laptop, which I won't put you through the pain of connecting my laptop again, it's got the contents bar on the web version. But when it gets into here, nicely enough, I guess, it takes off the bar because it wants you to see the whole picture, right? Okay, but the trick is, how do I go to the next slide? Okay, if I go to the next slide by sweeping, it works. Okay? Now, that might be just an instruction that we have to put on the title slide to advance, you know, because you've got two choices here. And it took me a while to figure this out. But you can sweep through, which is kind of a nice thing. You can do the gestures. The other tools do that as well. But it's not there with an instruction, right? The other thing you can do is you can click in the bottom right corner to get a menu to show up. The trick with this one is that it hides a little bit of content, right? So I had to figure that one out, and you notice that I don't have my click bubble there. So I believe what happened is it has something to do with the timing of the slide. I think I'm pretty sure if I had to build this over again, I could make the adjustment. Because I think what happens is that the slide is set to go for 5 seconds, like it's a default value. And I think the animation takes 6 seconds. This is my guess. So if I switch the timing of every slide to 6 or 7 seconds, maybe that's the answer. But now here, this is adding a little pop, and there's 3 balloons that are supposed to come up, right? But the balloons are not coming up. Okay? So what do I do with this? So I basically want to click on it, nothing, right? If I come down here, to my navigation, you can see that on the bottom there, the slide won't start until I click on the play button, right? So now I'll have to click on the play button here. And there's my balloon. And I can click on it and pop. Adobe Presenter, just to let you know, does transitions, slide transitions, and it does almost all the animations. And in fact, you know, Articulate Studio is doing more and more animations. It's just a few that it does not do. But it also does triggers, so Adobe Presenter does triggers as well. Now, click on the pop, and go to the next slide. Again, I'll sweep it. And now again, I have to click on this play button each and every time to get this thing to play. Now, if you had tested this on your workstation, you know, would you have ever known this? You know, you don't discover this until you actually go to one of those devices and start to use it, all right? And so in this case, if I want to keep on advancing, and you can see I froze up again. And I actually honestly didn't figure out what the deal was until later. Now, if I want to see all the navigation bar here, you see that when it's done, nicely enough, and the menu there is obvious. I can click on that menu, but what's it doing on the bottom? can't see some content, right? It's actually going overlapping on the content. And on the top, if I had any content as well, I'd be stuck with that content. So, last thing I'll show you, and again, I played around with different effects. Seems to work just fine, and the animations were fine. Again, it's just a little bit maybe user-unfriendly that, you know, it's not playing automatically on a lot of slides. But I'll show you the timeline interaction as well, just as kind of an ending. So the timeline interaction in this case, which I have to click on this to get it to show. Okay. Shows up like this. Oops. Okay. So first of all, it's hiding the bubbles on the bottom. I'm clicking away. Okay. So Adobe Presenter has, I think, again, around 20 interactions. It's great that it has those numbers. But again, if you don't try it and you can't see it, right, then you won't know that, okay, there's no way to break this into segments at the bottom into decade number one, decade number two, and decade number three. And then the bubbles are just kind of randomly spread up. So again, you know, I would have to try to test this to figure out, you know, what's working and what's not. And then when I click on the bubbles, not so much luck. Now, I can show you my phone, and you have to trust me. If you want to see more, I'm happy to show you the results on the phone, or I can even email you, you know, the links or whatever you need to test out on your own. But again, it's easy enough for you to create your own sample product, 10 slides, 15 slides, whatever you want to do, and then test it on the different devices and see how it works. Because on the phone, again, you'll see something very similar to this. The one thing that would be nice on the phone is that our iSpring takes a little bit of a different approach on the phone. For iSpring, it'll take off that menu completely and show you the full real estate. I think you guys have probably already seen that in some way, shape, or form. But it doesn't mask, you know, unlike Adobe Presenter, it won't mask all those different elements. Anybody here using Storyline? Yes? Lots. Okay. Wow. So, why not? Real quickly. We have time, right? Okay. Anybody curious to see how this works? Okay, so this is Storyline 2. I use Storyline, I'll tell you this. I have three clients right now. I'm an independent contractor. I work out of the Boston area. And I have four laptops. I have Storyline on all four laptops now. So, you know, it seems to be the way, right? So, my Storyline lesson I put together. In this case, I didn't. Okay, watch the pop. It worked, kind of. Anybody notice the difference there? One difference, there's no 3D graphics, right? So you couldn't get the look of the bubble. It does transparency, okay? But I fought with it. Tom will be able to figure this out, or somebody else that's a lot smarter than me will be able to figure this out. You don't even have to be that smart to be a lot smarter than me. But the bubbles, you know, were kind of tricky for me. Everything else worked just fine, with just the exception. There's some slide transitions that aren't there, okay? But it does slide transitions, all right? So you can do that. The graphics appear to be really good. It does, of course, triggers. Everybody knows Storyline does triggers. It does a phenomenal job at triggers. It does triggers. Which, by the way, we're gonna talk about PowerPoint-based tools versus Freeform tools today at 5 o'clock here. And so just in case, didn't catch this one. Joe Ganchi and I are going to be debating. I'll be playing the role of Hillary. I don't know what Joe's going to play. No, I'm not actually going to be Hillary. That'll be somebody else. But we're gonna debate. We're gonna have actually a political debate. It's election week, right? So we'll talk about all these different features or whatever. Believe me, that worked just fine. I found one thing that I wasn't really happy with. And again, my guess is there's a solution out there. So I went into good boss, bad boss. For those folks that have stopped by our booth, you probably have seen this before. So when you click on bad boss, everybody knows what happens when you have bad boss. You click on that, sorry, not happy, right? Good boss, we all want a good boss, right? Get you happy. And this is the one that I couldn't get to work. So in PowerPoint does so many great things with tracking and animations and whatever. It was really simple. Just to have that bubble go to the right, but then go backwards, right? In this case, I fought it for a while, and then I had to make it jump. It was the only way I could, so I basically made the first bubble disappear, and then I had the second bubble, you know, circle its way back. So that was the only challenge I had here. The other thing that I'll throw out is responsive design. I think Storyline's probably going to get there, but right now, you notice that the menu on the left, the font sizes are kind of small. They become really small when you have a phone, and basically when you're designing in Storyline, you have to think, okay, the device, because it won't adapt itself, device number one versus device number two. So the menu bar there, for the lessons that I've been designing, I've taken off the menu bar completely. You know, I basically have the navigation at the bottom, and I basically will say, okay, you know what, I'll instruct the user to get through this lesson, you know, just one way or another. It's not that difficult to do, but I've taken off the navigation bar because I think as you go downsize with your different devices, or what the different mobile devices at least, it gets much harder. And I don't have my final slide. I'm not going to hook up my laptop again. Okay, on my final slide, just to let you know, we have a thanks for coming, and then I put in something in there.
Did you like this video? Give it a like and subscribe to the iSpring YouTube channel for more updates.